Luke 24. If you have your copy of God's Word, go ahead and open it up there. If you have your app, you can get that out. We're going to put the text up on the screen as well. So welcome to Capshaw. My name is Zach. I'm one of the pastors here, and we're very delighted that you chose to celebrate Easter here with us today. We're talking about today, how does God open blind eyes? How does he take blind eyes and create blazing hearts? And we're going to see that in our story today in Luke 24. As you're finding your place there, I want to tell you about a lady named Elizabeth Marino. Elizabeth Marino was a avid Hillary Clinton fan, and she was doing all she could do to see Hillary get elected president of the United States. It was 3 days before the election, and she was out canvassing the community, registering people to vote, doing everything she could to make sure when election time rolled around that Clinton would be elected president. As a matter of fact, as she's going down the road, she gets a text message. The text message was from a pollster, and the pollster said there is a 75% chance that Clinton's going to be the next president of the United States. As she was looking at her text message, a jogger ran out in front of her, and she looked up just in time to swerve the car to miss the jogger, but she hit a concrete fixture and crashed her car into it and almost lost her life. She lived, but she went into a coma. And she was in a coma for the next over 3 months. It's a true story. I'm not making this up. When she woke up, she had no idea what happened. As she was coming to, as she was beginning to wake up, she asked the question, just in one word here or there, she would say, "Hillary, president?" And her children were there, her son and her daughter and the doctor said, "Whatever you do, don't startle her because it could send her back into a coma." And they looked at each other and they're like, "What do we say?" And the son laid a hand on her shoulder and said, "Mom, it's fine. Everything is good, Mom. It's okay." She said, "Phew." She went back to sleep. Later on, she got healthier and got stronger, and they released her from the hospital. It was after a couple of weeks, and she went home. Still not quite 100% yet, but she's back home, and they were eating breakfast one day, and she notices Donald Trump on television. They were keeping her from any media, from any news, afraid of what would happen if she realized that, you know, Hillary wasn't actually elected. And she sees Trump and she says, "I wonder why people are not more excited about Hillary. They keep showing Trump." She had an appointment with a masseuse, and she goes down to the massage place, and she's laying there on her tummy, and the lady's rubbing her back and working her shoulders, and the masseuse was from Russia. And so she said, "Well, what do you think about President Clinton?" And the lady said, "Well, you know, I didn't live here during his administration, but I heard he was great." And she said, "No, I mean Hillary." And the lady said, "Well, she gave it her best, didn't she?" And the subject changed. And the daughter's over there going, "Thank God," you know. And things began to keep adding up. And then finally, in one day, they're in the car, they're driving down the road, and it kind of clicks with Miss Marino that, you know, something is drastically wrong here. And she said, she looked, her son and her daughter were in the car with her, and she's sitting in the passenger seat, and she turns around and looks at her daughter, and she says, "You've lied to me, haven't you?" And the daughter had this shocked look on her face, and she said, "I wasn't out for 3 months. I was in a coma throughout Hillary's entire administration, throughout her whole presidency. You lied to me." And the son said, "Well, Mom, we didn't tell you everything, but no, we told you the truth about how long you were in a coma." And he had to get his phone out and show her the date so that she would realize, no, she had been out 3 months. And she says, "Well, what on earth has happened?" And he said, "Well, Hillary didn't win. Donald Trump is the president of the United States." And she just kind of looked up into the heavens, you know. And she said, "Well, why did you not tell me?" And they said, "Well, the doctor told us if we told you, it'd put you back into a coma." And she said, "Well, that just goes to show you the doctors don't know any more than the pollsters do." You know, when you wake up after an event like that, the first thing that you are concerned about tells a lot about you, doesn't it? obviously we see where her passions were and where her heart was at, because she was concerned about the outcome of the election, what she was thinking about before she went into a coma, and the first thing on her mind when she comes out. And probably the same would be true of all of us. What do you think was the first thing on Jesus' mind when he came back from the dead? I'm going to show you in today's text in Luke 24. Look with me at verse 13. This is all happening on the very first Easter. Earlier that morning before sunrise, Jesus had came out of the tomb. He was alive. His glorified state was, it was very unique. He both ate fish later that day. He still had scars, but he was glorified. He could walk through walls. He could appear and disappear. And so it was a unique mixture of the same yet different. And so Jesus here in verse 13 in Luke 24, it says that very day, two of them, that is two of his disciples, not of the 12, but of the larger number of followers of Jesus at this time, two of them were going to a village named Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. And they were talking to each other about all the things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing together, Jesus himself drew near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And they said, and he said to them, "What is this conversation you are holding with each other as you walk?" And they stood still, looking sad. They stopped, and even though normal people typically, even if we are sad, we try to cover it up. We try to put on a good face. We don't try to look like we're depressed or in despair or depression or whatever it might be, but these two men couldn't cover it up. It was obvious that they were downcast. Then one of them, verse 18, named Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only visitor to Jerusalem who does not know of the things that have happened there in these days?" Ironically, he was the only one who truly did know what had happened. But he was not revealing himself at this point. And he said to them, "What things?" And they said to him, "Concerning Jesus of Nazareth, a man who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and the rulers delivered him up to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we hoped he was the one to redeem Israel." Now we look at it through Christian eyes. We read the text through religious undertones. And so when we see redeem Israel, we think in terms of salvation, Christianity. That's not what they meant. They meant redeem us from the political oppression Rome had brought on to Israel. So, you know, this was the children of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. They were living in the land of promise, but Rome was occupying their territory. They had set up a puppet king. They had levied strong taxes against the Israelis, and they were looking for a Messiah, a new David, one who would come in and cast out Rome and set up his own kingdom. And they hoped it would be Jesus. A week ago on Palm Sunday, they had received him, blessed, Hosanna in the highest, the one who comes, the descendant of David. And they were waving palm branches as he rode into Jerusalem thinking, this is our king. But then seeing him upon a cross, their hope, their joy, their possibility for a better future nailed and crucified by the Romans. Imagine how that made them feel. And so these men were in despair. They were in despair because they saw redemption as something that happens in the physical sense. And generally, that's how we end up normally meeting Christ, is there's an issue in our life and we want God to make our condition better. We want him to fix things, our marriage, our work, our parenting, whatever it might be, but we want him to kind of fix our circumstances. And that's what we go to church, we get in a small group, we read a Christian book, we listen to a sermon, and we just want him to fix things and make it better. And here's the thing, oftentimes God can make your life. He said, I came to, that you may have life and have it more abundantly. God can improve your circumstances. If you follow Jesus, your marriage will be better than it will be if you don't follow Jesus. Parenting will be a better experience. You'll raise better children if you're following Christ than if you don't follow Christ. But if you come to God just to make your circumstances better and you don't deal with the real root problem, oftentimes you'll never really get the benefits of the better circumstances. You see, all of the problems, the stresses of your life, they're not the real problem. They're just the fruit. You got financial trouble, severe debt, you got problems with your marriage, you got problems in parenting, problems on the job, whatever, stresses, things that keep you awake at night. All of those things are just the fruit of a deeper problem. And they're meant to cause you to seek what is your real need for redemption. For them, it was Rome. And they saw Rome as the real problem. And Jesus is saying, no, I didn't come to deliver you from Rome. I came to deliver you from your sin. And once we deal with the sin, I can show you how to interact with Rome. But we've got to get first things first. He goes on in verse 21 and says, yes, and beside all of this, it is now the third day since these things happened. Moreover, and you got to forgive me, but you got to remember the time in which this was written. Women were not, they weren't even allowed to testify in court. And if any woman was allowed to testify, it would not have been Mary Magdalene. Mary Magdalene had 7 demons cast out of her. Church tradition believes that she was a woman of the streets. And when I think of Mary Magdalene, I think of that charismatic friend we all have. I mean, like, charismatic in the spiritual gift sense. So the Church of God friend that we have, the Assembly of God friend, the person who's like, they're always getting visions. You know what I'm saying? When somebody comes up and says, God spoke to me, like, of course God spoke to you. He's always talking to you. You know, that kind of friend. So that was a Mary Magdalene kind of person. It says, moreover, some of the women of our company amazed us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and they didn't find his body. They came back saying, they've seen a vision of angels. Of course they saw a vision of angels. Who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women said, but they did not see him. Now, it didn't click with them. Cleopas and his friend did not immediately think, so maybe he's risen. No, they had no category in their thinking for resurrection, not real resurrection. It was a theological concept that would happen out at the end of time somewhere, but one guy right in the middle being raised, they had seen resuscitation. They had seen Jesus speak to Lazarus and Lazarus come forth from the grave, but not to live forever. He came forth for a few days or a few years and he died again. But Jesus, alive forevermore. They had no category for that. And apart from resurrection, Jesus dying on the cross was devastating. That was their king. That was their hope. That was their Messiah. And he was crucified. And if they did believe in a resurrection or the possibility of it, it wouldn't be like this. It was so ordinary. So you have these two men, downcast, in despair, sad, and they go from that to, by the end of the story, we're going to continue reading in a moment, they have hearts ablaze. How did God open blind eyes and give them blazing hearts? What did Jesus do to get to that? Now the answer is going to surprise you. It's not going to impress you. As a matter of fact, I sort of wish it was more dramatic. I wish that it said right here, so Jesus zapped them. And suddenly they became flaming evangelists. You know, I wish it was something like that. I wish it was sort of like a Superman kind of story here. But it's incredibly normal, incredibly ordinary. And here's what I want to show you this morning. That's how God typically works. And what he's doing in your life right now is desiring to open blind eyes and set your heart ablaze. How will he do it? Let's look and see. Number one, he just joins them on their journey. He joins them on their journey. It's not spectacular. They're just walking. and Jesus comes to where they are. He goes and he walks with them. And that's typically what God does. I had the opportunity several years ago, on my one-year anniversary as pastor of this church, the church sent me to Israel, Julie and I to Israel. We saw all of the stuff I preach about. We went into the Garden Tomb. It was amazing. We had communion at the Garden Tomb. It was amazing. The little town of Bethlehem, we saw it. We saw where supposedly Jesus was born. We saw Golgotha. All of these things, the place of the skull. We saw all of this stuff. But the biggest surprise about Israel was that it wasn't a mystical kind of experience. It was just stuff. As a matter of fact, I didn't feel unusually close to the Lord on this pilgrimage. As a matter of fact, do you know where I've probably had my greatest experiences with God, where he's changed my life the most and tweaked my direction and revealed his will to me and showed me what he wanted for me the most? In a silver 2007 Dodge Ram parked right out here in the parking lot. I've probably had more interactions with the Lord on my drive time than I did in Israel. I'm not saying that to say don't go to Israel. It was great. I learned a great deal. I had a great experience, but nothing compared to some of the moments. And I could take you. It wasn't all in that truck. I could show you some that I had at different places at different times, but whether it's that 07 Dodge Ram or whether it's the Cracker Barrel rocking chair on my back porch, those times in just ordinary days, just normal experiences, Jesus walked into my life and I was aware of it and I listened. And my love for my wife, husbands love your wife as Christ loved the church and he laid down himself for her. Okay. It was to be, or wasn't a zap. It wasn't like, you know, we want it to be like on TBN. Have you ever noticed the guys who are on TBN are never on the radio? You have to see the video for it to be entertaining at all. Like if you just listen to what they said, you would be like, those guys are quacks. But man, you watch the show and it's pretty entertaining. I mean, you know, they come down and they zap them on the head. They start flipping back over seats and all this kind of stuff. And you're like, now that's how it ought to be. That's what life, man, it ought to be like that. And most of the time it's not. I'm not saying God never does anything like that, but most of the time, what he does is he just says, you need to put me first in your finances. You need to start raising your kids in the fear and admonition of the Lord and doing the things I told you to do in my word. You need to start loving your wife. And he just kind of joins you on your journey, and it's very non-flashy. It's very non-spectacular. But that's how God creates a blazing heart and eyes that see with 20/20 vision spiritually. Second thing he does, he just walks them through the word. Look at verse 25. And he said to them, O foolish ones and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Was it not necessary that the Christ should suffer these things and enter into his glory? And beginning with Moses and the prophets, he interpreted to them all the scriptures, the things concerning himself. Second way, God opens blind eyes and sets hearts ablaze just by getting in the Word, by reading the Bible. Jesus takes the Bible, and it says beginning with Moses and the prophets. Now, the first five books are attributed to Moses, so it's beginning with like Genesis. He's showing them himself. Let me show you here. Haven't you noticed? And he just starts showing them right after Adam's sin. Have you not noticed that Adam was covered from the shame of his nakedness by a sacrifice, that God made a sacrifice? He took the life of an animal and covered Adam's sin. Hadn't you read here where it says that that the serpent one day will have his head crushed by the male descendant of the woman? Didn't you know this had to happen? But in the process, haven't you noticed it says here that the serpent will bruise his heel? Didn't you see sacrifice had to happen, that death had to happen? What about Cain and Abel? Don't you see that the blood of Abel was crying out against Cain for his condemnation? In the same way, the blood of Jesus cries out for your, your justification. Don't you see? Don't you see? Don't you see here where Jacob wrestled with God so that he could be blessed? And don't you see that he was wounded in the process? And don't you see that Jesus also wrestling with God and he was wounded so that you could be blessed? Don't you see when you see Adam, don't you see that one sinned and all the rest suffered? Don't you see that through one man's righteousness, all the rest could be justified? Don't you see? Don't you see it in Isaac? Don't you see it in Joseph? Don't you see when Joseph suffered, he was condemned, but then he ascended to the right hand of Pharaoh so that he could provide for all of his people? Don't you see Moses struck the rock, and the rock, when it was struck, it brought forth water in the wilderness. Don't you see? And he just walks them through the scripture. Don't you see David? David, he's fighting Goliath, but as he fights Goliath, he fights and wins the battle, and all of the other army of Israel benefits from one man's victory. Don't you see? And he shows that one greater than Joseph has come, one greater than David, one in greater wisdom than Solomon in all of his glory, one greater than Joshua leading the armies of Israel, one greater than the prophets. Don't you see Samson? Samson, through his death, won a great victory. Don't you see? Don't you see the prophecies? Don't you see the types, the analogies? Don't you see that they were all pointing to what happened on Friday and what happened on Easter Sunday? Don't you see it? It had to happen this way. And as he was saying these things, their heart began to burn. They began to see that it's all about Christ. Now, how does God open blind eyes and set hearts ablaze? He walks into your life in the ordinary times and days, and he opens the Bible and he says, let me just show you myself through God's word. Thirdly, he communicates in the context of community. He communicates in community. Look at verse 28. It says, so they drew near to the village to which they were going, and he acted as if he were going farther, but they urged him strongly, saying, stay with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is now far spent. So they went in to stay with them. And he was at the table with them, and he took the bread, he blessed it, he broke it, and he gave it to them. And their eyes were open, and they recognized him. Now, a couple of other times in the Gospels, you see that phrase, he took it, he blessed it, he broke it. You see it at the feeding of the 5,000, the loaves and the fish. He took it, he blessed it, he broke it, and he gave it to them. You see it at the Last Supper. He took the Passover. He took it, he blessed it, he broke it, and he gave it to them. Now, there was something about that clicked with them. When they heard him pray, when they saw him distributing the elements of the dinner, for all practical purposes, having communion with them, it clicked with them, and their eyes were open. It all came together. History can be described, somebody said, as a series of great events or great people. The Bible suggests that it could also be described as a series of great meals. In the beginning, the first event that we have in human history is a meal. They got cast out of the garden for taking the fruit and eating it. At the end of time, when everything is said and done, and God has judged the world, and he's glorified his people, at the end of time, we see a meal, the marriage supper of the Lamb. You see, a couple of great meals between that. You see Passover during the Exodus, and you see communion of the Lord's Supper for the church. And so you see these series of meals, because a meal in the Jewish context speaks of fellowship. It speaks of two people who are at peace. Enemies didn't eat meals. It always spoke of community and communion. And Jesus breaking bread with Cleopas and his friend. was saying, because of what I did on Friday, we don't have to be enemies anymore. And the goal of the kingdom, the objective of the kingdom, God and man at table sat down as friends, has been accomplished. And it clicked with them that this had to happen. It had to go down the way it went down. And it's real. And we're at peace with God because of Jesus. Then you see the early church, not surprisingly, from that day on, anytime you see the early church, you see them together with the word, in community, breaking bread over and over and over again. The Bible says in the book of Acts, it says in Acts 2:46, this also written by Luke, day by day, attending temple together, breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. The Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. How did they grow the church in Acts? What was their evangelistic strategy? Lunch. They hung out, they talked about Jesus, and they ate food. They were Baptists, my friend. There's something about eating. There's something about meals. There's something about sitting down with people who've gotten in on what you've gotten in on and breaking bread and just being friends and doing community together. And it's through that he opens blind eyes and he sets hearts ablaze. I wish I could tell you, you wanna have your heart set on fire for Jesus? Well, I'm gonna zap you in Jesus' name. I wish I could tell you that. But it's as simple as this. Walk with Jesus, read your Bible, and join a group. That's it. 1994. The last thing on my mind is God. I am not looking for God. I'm going to college. I didn't really want to go to college. Of all the colleges I could have gone to, I didn't want to go to the one close to home, but that was the one I got in. So I got accepted to. So I went to the University of North Alabama. Had the sweet car. I had a nice 1994, I think at that point, I was in a Camaro, a white Camaro. It was awesome and you know, newly graduated. I was more concerned with girls than I was God, all right? And I'm there, my first day of class, I got a letter that said, you better get there early, and because first day of class, there's a lot of construction, and you may not get a parking spot if you don't get there early. So I got there really early. I parked in Kilby School parking lot across the street from UNA, and I'm just sitting there in my Camaro, flipping through the radio, trying to find a good song to listen to kind of help me get woke up. I'm eating my biscuit from McDonald's, drinking a Coke, and minding my own business. And the stereo's cranked up, and it comes across this guy who's talking like I'm talking to you right now. Now, you got to realize, the church I grew up in, the preacher was a hacking preacher. Y'all, you know what that means? And the Bible says, if you love the Lord, you'll tithe, you'll go to church. That's a hacking preacher. And that's what, in my mind, that was preaching. Now, this guy wasn't doing that. He was just talking. I thought it was the news, to be honest with you. 106.3, Charles Stanley. I hear it, and he says things like, your salvation isn't about what you did at the altar or what you did in the baptistry. It's about what Jesus did on the cross. And I'm like, really? It's not about me. It's about what he did. He said, as a matter of fact, your salvation was all the work for your salvation was done 2,000 years ago. You just need to receive it. I'd never thought of it that way before, that it was all about Jesus and the cross. It wasn't so much about me, stop cussing, stop drinking, stop doing this, stop doing that. It was about what Jesus did. And I realized, I'm listening to a preacher. I turned it down because I was embarrassed. God has a flair for irony, doesn't he? That I would choose this particular career field. it chose me. I didn't choose it. But I turned down the radio, and I thought, I want to hear more what he's saying. I listened to it. when it was time to go to class, I didn't want to leave. I wanted to keep listening. As a matter of fact, I went through Drop Ad that day, and that's where you can change all your classes around. I said, I'm not going to take anything until after 11:30, because I realized that preachers were on from like 8 o'clock till 11:30, and I wanted to hear them. So I went through Drop Ad, dropped all of my classes, took after lunch classes for the rest of that first semester, and I was hearing Charles Stanley, Chuck Swindoll, J. Vernon McGee, Adrian Rogers, Focus on the Family, all that stuff on the radio, and I was learning and I was growing and I was seeing Jesus. I heard Dr. Stanley say, you should get a copy of my devotional book and begin spending time with God each day and reading some verses and some commentary. And okay, where do you get it? He said, you can find it in your local Christian bookstore. I didn't realize Christians had their own bookstores. I didn't know that. I'm like, do you have your own car lots? Do you have your own? I mean, what is this? So I find we have a Christian bookstore downtown. And so I go down to the Christian bookstore, and sure enough, there was a big display with Dr. Stanley's newest devotional book. And I go and I'm looking through it, and I'm sitting there and I'm kind of flipping through the book, you know, checking the price, all that, and I look up, and this little redheaded girl named Kara was looking at a book down beside me, and she had English literature, the same class that I took. And she looked at me, and she went, Zach Terry, are you a Christian? I said, I guess, you know, I don't know, really. And she's like, well, you need to come to the Baptist Campus Ministry. And I'm like, okay, she was cute, you know, I'll check it out. So I went to the BCM. I made some Christian friends. Next thing you know, I've got my best friend as a Christian, and we're talking about the stuff that God's showing us and the gospel, and suddenly I've got more in common with these church folks than I do my band that I played music with, and it's like, wow, this is odd. I mean, I wasn't looking for this. A young lady came up to me and said, it's friend day at my church this Sunday. Would you be my friend and go to church? She was cute too. So I said, yes, I will be your friend. And I went with her. And I got plugged in with a group. I got in Sunday school and began learning and growing and being taught the word. And literally it changed my life. My life radically changed. I remember it was a Christmas party probably that same year, and we were at the Christmas party, and one of my uncles asked my father, he said, why is Zach not pursuing the entertainment career? Because I started school in a band and really wanting to kind of go to Nashville and be in the industry somewhere, probably as a manager or studio producer or something, and that's what my education was for. He said, why is he not pursuing that? And Dad said something to the effect of, well, you know, a lot's changed in his life. He's really got into his faith, and he's really changing, and he's not really wanting to do that anymore. I'll never forget what my uncle said. He said, they go through this in college, he'll get over it. That was 23 years ago. I'm not over it. Now, what happened? How did I go from blind eyes to a burning heart? And how, 23 years later, is it still burning? My marriage is still good. My kids are being raised in the fear and admonition of the Lord. I see nothing in my future that causes me to want to withdraw from the things of God. I want to know. I'm learning more. I'm growing more than I ever have in my life. How is that possible? Oh, you got to get zapped. You got to get anointed with oil. You got to get knocked down by Benny Hinn. No, none of that. It's very, very simple. Jesus walked into my life and he sat down beside me in a 1994 Camaro. I started reading the Bible and hanging out with Christians. And Jesus, when he got up from the tomb on Easter Sunday, did the same thing. Simple as that. Walk with Jesus, read your Bible, get in a group. And some of you are here today, and I want you to hear I love you. I'm so thrilled you're here. We're honored with your presence. But let me tell you something really, really honest. In 20 years, some of y'all won't be in church. Some of y'all won't be in church in 2 years if something doesn't change. Some of you won't be married in 2 years if something doesn't change. Hearts tend to drift. You got to have a plan. You got to have a plan to keep your heart ablaze. And I want to suggest to you, it's right there. Walk with Jesus, get in the Word, join a group. And the invitation today is so simple. I mean, if you want to get saved, if you're here, you're up in the balcony. We've had more and more people coming to Christ out of the balcony lately. You're a little closer to the Lord than the rest of us. Think about it. So it should be easy for y'all. But we'll have somebody up there willing to talk with you and to show you the gospel, how you can be forgiven and start over afresh and anew today. We're going to have three guys down here at the front, and they can talk with you and pray with you. You can get saved today. So we're going to do that kind of invitation. If you're here and you need to join the church, they can help you with that. All you got to do is come up and say, I want to join the church. They'll walk you through it. But here, for most of us, here's the invitation. Are you going to recognize that the fact that you're here is Jesus walking into your journey, joining you on the journey? Are you going to commit to just getting in the Word? Maybe picking back up on the read through the Bible in a year, maybe going through a Bible study, whatever it might be. You're going to get in the Word. And you're going to find a few other people who believe this is true as well. Maybe next week, 9 o'clock, you're going to be in small group. You say, well, how do I do that? It's real simple around here. If you just show up in the Family Life Center, the Rambies are typically over there. They're awesome. We've got people working those doors, and they are so thrilled. They have a gift for that, and they can show you. Usually they look at you and say, oh, you need to be in this class. And they'll put you in a class. It's real simple. You can email Pastor Adam from capshaw.org. Go find his email and say, where do I go? What do I do? We got places for your kids, little babies, whatever it might be. 9 o'clock next week, get in a group. And it won't be like, you know, some mystical experience, but you're going to recognize over the course of the next few weeks, months, and years, your marriage is going to change. Your finances are going to change. Your parenting's going to change. And you're going to suddenly sit back and go, wow, I'm no longer blind. My heart is ablaze. The plan worked.